It's episode 25 of Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball. I'm Daron Vaught. I hope you're well. Thanks, as always, for listening, subscribing, downloading, rating, reviewing, wherever you get your podcasts, Apple, Spotify, Google, or if you listen via the USA Baseball YouTube channel. Most of us discovered our love of the game of baseball when we were young and maybe had just started playing organized sports. Most of us first dream of being a star player. You make diving plays, tossing a ball up to yourself in the backyard. You imagine the roar of a crowd as you swing an imaginary walk-off home run. Most of us also never make it to the big leagues, or even close. Our days of playing baseball and pouring ourselves into our passion that way come to an end. Well, then what? I think that question is fascinating to ask almost any former athlete because of both its importance and its complexity. That's one of the topics we'll get into with Troy Tulowitzki on this edition of the podcast. He was the Colorado Rockies shortstop who set Major League Baseball ablaze with his hot start to his career, playing in the World Series at 22 years old. He idolized Derek Jeter and was dubbed the next Jeter by many at that point. Though he still had a great playing career, it was cut short by injuries. And since then, he has moved back to the college ranks to become a coach, where he's on staff for the Texas Longhorns. A gold medalist on the Collegiate National Team in 2004, we tap into Tulo's USA Baseball experience as well. So let's get to it. Episode 25 of Covering the Bases with Troy Tulowitzki. Colin, roll the open, please.
From high above Coleman Field at the USA Baseball National Training Complex in Cary, North Carolina, this is Covering the Bases with Daron Vaught.
All right, Troy Tulowitzki. I think, you know, normally I like to do these, Tulo, in sort of a chronological manner, but given your current role as an assistant coach at Texas with the Longhorns, let's talk about that first. What stemmed from what I imagine was a very difficult decision to retire from playing baseball, followed by an exciting choice to get into coaching? What all went into this progression and your next steps?
I think everybody's career has to come to an end at some point. And knowing how much I love the game, love being around it, unfortunately, you know, about the last couple of years of my career, I had some time to think about what I wanted to do next. So I knew I wanted to stay in the game. I always loved college baseball. I knew I wanted to be in a good area to raise, you know, my family, and things came together. Austin worked out, and then the University of Texas, you know, we made it work. So it's been a great relationship so far. Just pouring every, you know, bit of knowledge that I've learned throughout this game just into the kids and really trying to make a difference in their life.
Is coaching something you always imagined you would be interested in, no matter when your playing days were over? Did you always see yourself continuing a career beyond playing within baseball?
Yeah, I've always been a teacher at heart. Even when I really felt like I've been a coach my entire career, because no matter what age group, even, you know, I can go back to as far as when I was a rookie in the big leagues. I always remember being a student of the game, being able to listen and apply, but then also teaching people what I knew about the game. So I knew from an early age, I would say, that, okay, at some point in time, I want to be a coach.
And what age did it become clear to you that you were going to ride out baseball as a player as long as possible? I think most guys who play probably remember the idea of, hey, it would be cool to be a big leaguer at, you know, something in the single digits. At what point did it become a bit more realistic to you, right? Like, hey, I could actually do this.
Yeah, there's definitely two parts to that question. I'd say, you know, it was a dream of mine, you know, probably 5-6 years old when I knew what a big leaguer was, and watching it on TV or having my dad talk to me about, hey, these are the best players in the world. Right then and there is when, okay, hey, that's a dream of mine and I want to accomplish that. I wouldn't say it became reality or, hey, like you said, I can do this until probably about when I got to college at Long Beach State. I would say there would be some former big leaguers or guys that were playing at the time in the big leagues would come out on our field. And as soon as they came out on our field, I'd start to measure up his game and say, all right, how far away am I from this guy, or do I belong? And I started seeing guys that I don't think he's much better than me. That's when I knew I had a real chance.
How has baseball at the college level changed since you were playing? I mean, that was the mid-2000s. You were a star at Long Beach State. You're around it every day now. It's a game I think we would both be at the same level of appreciation for it. What's changed the most in the past 15 years or so?
I think the technology. There was always, let's say, analytics in the game. We just went about it a different way to where now it's much easier to get the information. You don't have to sit there and chart where one guy's hitting it with a piece of paper and drawing lines. Now you can just, you know, kind of plug it into the computer and it spits it out. Hey, this is where majority of the balls are being hit. So that's changed. Scouting reports, you know, hit tracks. We can get into all the technology thing. But the game still honestly remains the same. You play it in between the white lines, until someone can measure someone's heart, someone's baseball IQ, then you have to take that stuff. Not that it can't help you, but for me, with a grain of salt and really, stick to the things that you know best.
So with the technology in mind, that's interesting to me because, you know, you entered the big leagues at what, 21, 22 years old. To what degree did that evolve just while you were still playing?
Yeah, no, it evolved a lot over the years. You saw it, but at the same time, I had some great people that I followed in the Todd Heltons of the world, Matt Holliday, and we really did it from work ethic, talking the game of baseball before and after the game, spending long nights inside the cage, really dissecting our swing. We used some video, there was no doubt, but I feel like we got better from just knowing ourselves as good as anybody and really understanding we are our best hitting coach and we kind of drive the bus. And they did a good job of making me understand that to where, hey, you're in control of your career. Why would you want to leave it in someone else's hands?
So how about now speaking again of players at the college level, what about just in their worlds, emotionally, personally, maybe the school aspect of it? I would imagine playing with younger guys into your later MLB days too has helped with this, but have you found that you're able to easily relate to those guys?
Yes and no. I would say yes, because we both share a passion of baseball, and we both are there every day for a reason, to try to grow individually as people first, and then baseball players as well. So, you know, we speak the same language. But at the same time, I would say no, because I don't think they've reached that level quite yet to know exactly what it takes to be the best in the world. And I think that's what I try to challenge them every day to understand is, look, it was very hard for me when I was your age. I wasn't just all of a sudden good. I had to put in the work. And I think sometimes they look at certain players like, this guy was just really, really good right from the get-go. And that's just not the case with anybody. I've seen the best players in the world crying after games. I've seen how hard it really is to stay at the top of your game. And I share that as much as I can with these kids. And if they can ever just grasp that it's within their reach, then that's when I feel like I can get the kid to turn the corner and make him realize it's okay to dream big.
What's it like being at Texas? Like, you played your final major league game with the New York Yankees, which we'll get to, but you went from that to sort of going to the Yankees of college baseball. Has it lived up to the hype, you know, the buzz constantly surrounding the program and everything that's entailed with that?
Yeah, I don't think that's coincidence either. I'm sure other people have picked up on that, and obviously you have too. But, you know, being with the Yankees was always, let's say a dream of mine. Derek Jeter was my favorite player. Had a chance to join the organization trying to make a comeback after a couple surgeries. And I wanted to be a part of something that was great. I wanted to see how greatness operated on a daily basis. So I got to see how the organization was ran from the top to the bottom. And I understood at the end of the day, all right, this is why they're the New York Yankees. So fast forward a little bit, and, you know, you look out in the college baseball, I kind of threw my name out there, told some people I was interested in getting into college baseball. And when Texas came calling, you know, for me, it was kind of a no-brainer, because when I think about college baseball, one of the first programs that pops into my mind is the University of Texas. The tradition, the history, what they stand for. And when I've always been a firm believer in, you know, you kind of are who you surround yourself with. And if I can surround myself with the best people, at what they do, then hopefully I can learn something each and every day. So I think I did that with the Yankees. And I'm doing that here at the University of Texas as well, and trying to share my knowledge, but at the same time, seeing how the best operates.
You know, we all perceive it that way when it comes to the Yankees and Texas baseball. I don't want you to give away any trade secrets that you don't have to, but what have you noticed within infrastructures of both that sort of make them both great? I don't even know that it necessarily makes them similar, other than in their own respects, they're great. Is it a fair comparison? What have you noticed that aligns between the two?
I think you don't settle for anything but the best. You step into the Yankees clubhouse, the goal is to win a World Series. Simple, right? Not every organization goes for that. It's let's develop, or let's see if we can be a wild card, or let's just see how the season plays out. It's clear message. Hey, we're trying to win a World Series, and that's each and every year. You can tell by the way that they attack the free agent market, just the way they go about their business. It's about winning. Now, there are a lot of organizations that talk about winning, but that's not what their actions do. When you go to the University of Texas, same thing. Goals to get to Omaha, whereas other programs, that might not be the goal. So I think it's a common goal. It's clear communication, and each place will do everything within the rules to accommodate their players to be the best.
Wow. What are your feelings on Austin? And had you really had a chance to be in the city and visit prior to your stint here?
I've heard great things about Austin. Obviously, I was really close with Houston Street. He's a teammate of mine in Colorado. He used to always talk to me about Austin. And I always knew when I retired that I liked the idea of being close to a lake. That's kind of my getaway, is to get, you know, to go fishing, to get on a boat, to do those water sports. So really, Austin had everything for me. It had that. It was a great place to raise a family. And then I got to drive to the baseball field every day. That's a perfect day for me.
What about some of the other sports? Have you checked out like a Texas football game, basketball game? I call college basketball as well, and I got to go to do a game at Texas for the very first time this past January, and was in awe because, you know, you go in and the administrators are telling you, yeah, we've got this plan for a new basketball arena, and you know, for the time I was calling High Point University men's basketball. So we walk in and we're like, well, what's wrong with this one? Pretty great facilities wise and all that stuff. Have you checked any other events out?
Yeah, I've been everywhere. You know, I'm always trying to pick the brains of the other coaches on campus, whether it be football, basketball, men's swimming, whatever it is, you know, trying to get better, trying to learn some things that I can apply to make me a better coach. So, yeah, I spent a lot of time in those different sports. Like you said, that's the thing about the University of Texas is they want the best of everything, whether it be facilities, players. They demand a lot. I think the pressures are real. It's there, but that's always attractive. I love pressure. I love that, hey, winning is nothing else is acceptable. I love being in that, and I don't think that's for everybody, but I've learned that with me at a young age that's just it wasn't worth playing for me unless there was something on the line, unless people demanded a lot out of you. So it's right where, you know, I should be and kind of the situation that I thrive in.
You can never have too many USA Baseball caps, and New Era just dropped the brand new USAB 5950 at usabaseballshop.com. This cap comes in both navy and gray, and it features raised USA Baseball text embroidered on the front. A sleek, simple design, and a perfect addition to your collection. Also, from Baseballism, new colorways in some of their classics, such as the Four Glory Tee, now available in navy and maroon. You can also find new colors for the popular Eagle Tee and much, much more. So head on over to usabaseballshop.com today. Well, let's move on. This is the USA Baseball Podcast, so we have to talk about your Team USA experience. And in 2004, you were a member of the Collegiate National Team. You guys won gold at the World Baseball Championships in Taiwan. A lot goes into experiencing that for the first time. And I talk with guys every year who are new to the experience and new to the National Training Complex and carry, and they walk in and get the uniform with USA across the chest and meet this entire team of star players. What were your first impressions of walking into the same meeting room with that team?
I was there to prove myself, to be honest. I knew it was the best players in college baseball, but at the same time, I wanted to be the best player on that team. So that's just kind of me. I'm super competitive. So, you know, right away, I took it as that. And then when we settled, we figured out who made the team. Then it was, all right, let's do something special here. I remember us struggling a little bit early, and I remember Coach came up to me, who was Elliot Avent, who's the head baseball coach at NC State.
Oh, yeah.
And he really challenged me and said, you know, I see you as a leader on this team and someone that really, you know, the other guys kind of rally around. He goes, you need to get out of your comfort zone a little bit and demand some things for some people. So I did that. Opened myself up a little bit and kind of challenged the team, challenged myself. And, you know, I think that really worked, and it taught me something that, hey, don't just settle with just being on a good team. Get the most out of the guys around you. And, we, like you said, we ended up winning a gold medal, but talk about the excitement to wear USA across your chest. The emotions that come with that. It's an honor. It's something I'll never forget, and probably one of the greatest accomplishments I've had in my baseball career.
That's all cool stuff. Elliot is one of my favorite coaches. I'm based in Raleigh, so I end up doing a lot of their games and interact with him a lot. That summer was a loaded infield, and you talk about going in trying to prove yourself. Well, when you see guys like Ryan Zimmerman, Alex Gordon, Jed Lowry surrounding you, what was it like? Was it kind of icy between all of you guys from day one?
Well, it's funny because when I was going to tryouts, I remember right when I left, a couple of people said, hey, just have fun at the tryouts. You're not going to make the team, but just go out there and kind of one of those do your best speeches.
Huh.
And I said, well, what's going on? Why won't I make the team? They said, well, the returning player is a kid by the name of Tyler Green, and he was the best player on the USA team the year before. He hit something like 370 for them in summer. So I said, okay. So I remember getting there, and that really drove me during those tryouts. Every single thing I did, I was trying to put it to Tyler Green. Now, Tyler Green, a great guy, someone that I admired, someone that had a great career. But at the same time, when I was there, I was trying to stick it to him. So the tryouts ended. They ended up cutting Tyler Green and keeping me. And once again, that was a lesson for me to say, all right, if you're ever in that situation, there's always people right behind you. You can never get complacent.
I imagine your answer to this, without a qualifier, is going to be Troy Tulowitzki. But besides Troy Tulowitzki, who was the most talented person on that team?
Oh, Ryan Zimmerman for me. Zim was phenomenal with the glove, with the bat. He definitely hit the best that summer out of those guys. And then you can just tell he enjoyed playing the game. He loved going to practice. He had that work ethic. He was special. And I saw that right away. We became good friends and still talk to this day. There's so many great guys on that team, honestly. Alex Gordon really sticks out work ethic wise, second to none. I remember we would, be planning to go grab something to eat before or after a game. Man, Alex, I knew where he was every single time. He was in the hotel gym. The work ethic was phenomenal, and I knew he was going to be good for a long time. And he's still doing it, and there's that tells you why right there.
What about on the pitching side? Did anyone now? I always love seeing the mix of conference to conference guys who likely didn't see each other within their collegiate seasons in the spring facing off. Was there anybody that you hadn't seen their stuff that really stood out? Because especially during trials, I mean, you're seeing nothing but pitching of your teammates at that point.
Luke Hochaver, he was probably the eighth of our staff. He ended up being, I believe, the number one pick. So he was phenomenal, and he stood out to me because before he started every time, he would go around and grab everybody's cleats the night before the game and clean them. So that just shows you, preparation, intent, knowing and having a plan and not veering from it. Now, I always remember that, and that's always something that stuck with me. Jay Brent Cox, who went to the University of Texas, you talk about mentality and someone that you wanted that guy on the mound because of how great he competed. He was that guy for us when we would go to the bullpen or close out a game. I can go on and on with those guys, but those two guys really stood out to me. Ricky Romero, who happened to be someone I faced a lot.
Yeah.
Because he went to Cal State Fullerton, but, he had a devastating breaking ball and just competed. I think that's the one thing that stood out from all those guys is they competed at the highest level. And that's the reason why they're the best players.
Can you go back over the Luke story with cleaning the cleats? What was the whole gist behind that?
Yeah, I mean, when he knew he was pitching, obviously he was a starter. Kind of our go-to guy. Every big game, he seemed to start for us. So, sure enough, like clockwork, it'd be around 7:30 to around 8 o'clock. You get a knock on your room, and you'd open it up, and there would be Luke with his, brush, a little bubbles, clean your cleats up ready to real quick. And it was basically, I think, his way to say, hey, get a good night's sleep. I'm taking care of you right here. Take care of me tomorrow. That was kind of a message that I felt that he was sending.
That's really cool. So you guys played a series in Japan against Japan before going to win the World Baseball Championships in Taiwan. And the international travel component of that experience is one that I like to ask about most because you can get a lot of interesting nuggets out of people, right? Just from a human element. Some guys who are 20 years old haven't done much international travel or seen much of the world in that way. Was that the case with you prior to those two huge trips?
Yeah, for sure. It was a kind of a shock to see how you know, people operate outside your own little bubble that you hadn't seen much more than that. So to see how, you know, that culture worked and how much they appreciated the game, and they thought we were rock stars over there. I remember them, you know, jumping up and down on our bus, trying to ask for our Oakley sunglasses. You know, those stories stick out that I'll remember. But what I do remember over there is they put it on.
Yeah.
they beat us up, but it was, that's why I said we kind of struggled early, and it was an eye opener to say, hey, if we want to win a gold medal and we end up going to Taiwan, we're going to have to get our act together and play as a team, to kind of accomplish what we set out to accomplish at the beginning. And we did that, and we ended up, you know, beating Japan for the gold medal, which is, you know, I don't think we get that done if they put it on us kind of early.
What was the dugout like for most of that series? Because at the same time, like you said, everybody's kind of receiving at their own rate of progress the culture shock to whatever degree they're experiencing it. You guys are getting beaten up pretty badly, so you're obviously trying to make adjustments in between the lines. Was there a sort of a pivotal moment where you guys, you knew that you were going to take something from it?
I'll leave you with, you can, Elliot Avent will probably be able to paint the picture a little bit better than I will. I think it basically came down to us playing as a team and to stop, you know, worrying about our draft stock or whatever it is, and really to play for the USA across our chest. I think once we figured that out, there was no stopping us, but it took us a while to get there.
If that means Elliot had to get into you guys a couple of times, it doesn't surprise me. B, I'm excited to talk to him off the air about those conversations. So that's fun.
Perfect.
So moving into your pro career, which got off to a fast start early, you wore number two. You alluded to Derek Jeter earlier. What about Jeter made that so important to you that you wanted to even go as far as wearing his jersey number when you got to the big leagues?
He did it on and off the field. I think everybody knows Derek Jeter, the Hall of Famer, all the stats, but to do it in a city of New York where, you know, all the eyes are on you every single game, and off the field as well. I think he handled the media as a professional. I think he always said the right thing at the right time, and he played the game at its simplest form and just cared about winning. And that was always something that I strive to do. Now, I definitely probably didn't do it as good as Derek Jeter, but at the same time, he was a great role model for me and someone that just by watching, I learned so much. So that's what I saw. It was a professional in every sense of the word. And I don't think there's a better guy in the game. I think sometimes when you kind of meet your idol and you get let down, like, oh man, I liked that guy for that long. Well, I had the opposite experience. You know, I got to meet Derek, and every single time he was respectful to me, great conversation, encouraged me, just always said the right thing. And that made it that much more special to me to say, all right, that was a good read by me. That I thought he did things the right way, and he was a professional because he was every bit of that.
What was it like the first time you met him? And where was it? Was that maybe not until your first All-Star game?
No, I believe New York, they came to Colorado early in my career. I don't know if it was my first or second year. We actually swept them in Colorado. And I actually believe I hit a 3-run homer against Roger Clemens. And I'm 21 years old or something. I had been, you know, watching Roger Clemens as long as I can remember. And then, you know, I hit a home run off of him. And that was like my first aha moment. Like, wow, I came a long way and I'm finally a big leaguer.
So what was the exchange with Jeter like? I mean, pretty limited, right? If it's in a game scenario.
It was funny, man, because everybody knew we were, you know, New York was, you know, coming to the Coors Field, and they were on me pretty hard. What are you going to do when you see him? You're going to talk to him, this and that. So I get to the field, and I forget what it was called, but Derek Jeter had a cologne at the time. So I walk into my locker before I get to the game, and I have this cologne everywhere in my locker. And all the guys are saying, oh, before you go talk to him, you better put on his cologne. That he'll talk to you more. So, you know, I'm a young player. They're still razzing me. I had fun with it, you know. I was always someone that just played the game with them. So I sprayed the cologne all over me. You know, I'm playing the game, doing all those things. And I just made fun of the situation. That always got them off my back a little bit. And I saw him in BP, said, what's up? You know, I told him he was my favorite player. And then once it was time to play ball, I competed like I always did and wasn't, you know, in awe. I was trying to, you know, win every pitch. So, you know, fast forward, now I'm starting to see him at all-star games, things like that. We're two of the better shortstops in the game. And I think we just had that respect for one another. And, you know, I always tried to do that to younger players that came up to me after that and said, hey, I've watched you for a long time. I try to treat them just like Derek treated me.
Are there any other players besides Derek that stick out as you know, someone you emulated coming up?
There's so many, honestly, but I'll just touch on a few of my favorite players. And one of my favorite players, actually, pretty much the same age as me. I think he's probably a year older than me, and it's Dustin Pedroia. Mm-hmm. You know, I got a chance to play against Dustin when he was at Arizona State, and I was Long Beach, and I was immediately like, wow, that's the type of baseball player that I want to be. You talk about high energy, really, really good, grinded out at bats, just played the game how I always believe it should be played. And I loved watching his career unfold, because I remember during the draft, people say, ah, well, he's too small and it's not going to work at the big league level. And I just knew it was. And then you watch him, I believe, get Rookie of the Year. The next year, he's the MVP. And he was one of my favorite guys to watch. I always looked at it and said, if that guy can win an MVP, it always gave me hope that I could win one. So he's probably one of my favorite players that was the same age as me. But man, there's so many, you know, from Nomar to Jeter to Cal Ripken. I can go on, and you know, I'll mostly stick at the shortstop position. But I had great teammates, great coaches. There's so many people that played a part in my career.
Well, that actually is a pretty good segue, because when you with the Rockies went to the World Series, at, I believe, still 22 years old, right? Maybe you had turned 23 by that point, but it was the Red Sox that you guys faced. And I think this is something, a situation in your life and career that sort of perfectly aligns with your role now in teaching guys in their early 20s, teenage years about the game. At that point, did you believe you would make it to another World Series?
You know what? I definitely didn't, because growing up, I was a Miami Dolphins fan, and my dad was my coach growing up, and we just talked about sports all the time. And Dan Marino made it to the Super Bowl his rookie year. And my dad growing up would just tell me all the time, see, that's why you can't take it for granted. That's why you just never know if you'll get back. You'll never know if you'll be able to win one. So I was probably one of the few guys that realized this isn't normal. I might never make it again, so take it all in and learn from this experience. So, you know, thank God my dad, you know, giving me those speeches and watching games with me and telling me about, you know, the history of, you know, what Dan Marino went through, and he never ended up winning a Super Bowl. I understood what I was going through even at that young age.
You did something else that year that is a play that is A, historic, and B, includes another USA Baseball alum who we've had on this podcast. Off the bat of Chipper Jones, you turned, it's kind of weird to say that you turned an unassisted triple play, because it's unassisted and there is no turn ever. But you had an unassisted triple play in 2007. If I'm not mistaken, it was the 13th in the history of Major League Baseball, which seems like a lot to me, because that's such a rare play. What do you remember about it? Because it happened in the blink of an eye.
Oh, man. I mean, I'm sitting here, you know, what is it? You know, 13 years later talking about this play, and I've talked about it so much, and it happened in a couple seconds, and I didn't even know how historic it was when it happened. I remember it happened. I even threw the ball in the stand as I was going off the field, because I didn't understand. I didn't understand at the time that, you know, only 13 people had done that in the history of the game. It was kind of, all I did was catch the line drive, step on second, and then tag the guy, you know, coming from first. So it wasn't the hardest play at all. So you think when you're doing something historic, you know, you're doing something crazy, or whether it be fielding percentage, or you're just doing something unheard of on the field. I could have put my, you know, 6-year-old son out there that day, and he could have done the same thing I just did. So, you know, it's funny because I talk about it all the time, but in reality, it was a pretty simple play.
Yeah, I mean, like maybe one of the simplest you ever made defensively, but for whatever, you know, because it recorded three outs simultaneously, it's the one that gets talked about. And I mean, you got a couple gold gloves. You have plenty of other more difficult defensive plays.
Correct.
Well, let's talk about All-Star games. You made five of them. Your first was in 2010. Now, you had already arrived to a certain degree by that point. But what was that experience like for the first time being thrown into that collection of players? It's a little bit more of a celebratory thing. So it's not quite like your experience with the Collegiate National Team, where you would necessarily be going in with this huge chip on your shoulder for your first All-Star game in 2010. What was it like?
Yeah, you can tell, I'm probably a little different. I always try to keep that chip on my shoulder. I just think it made me go. It made me who I was, and it constantly made me play the game the right way. And I try to keep it. And I think I did that for, you know, almost my whole career. But even there, honestly, you know, you're with the best players in the world. You know that you've made it, because of who's in that locker room. So I think you go there, and honestly, I tried to go there and be a student. I tried to pick the brains once again of the best players in the world and saying, all right, what can I get from these guys that can make me the best player in the game? Because that's what I always would try for. I wanted to be the best player in the game, and I wanted to be the best player in the game because I felt like that would give my team the best chance to win. And at the end of the day, that was my goal, was to always, you know, win a World Series, help us get to the playoffs, whatever it may be. So I went there and tried to just be a student, pick the brains of the best players in the world, and apply it to my game. Whether I was, you know, in the locker room, on the bench, I'd go up to whoever it was and just say, hey, I got a question here. Can you help me with it? And those guys love talking about the game. It's why they're the best. So I always took an All-Star game serious and tried to get something out of it.
Who did you get the most out of that year, or maybe in other years? When you think of, you know, learning from other players at All-Star games, who comes to mind?
Scott Rowland. I would say I always liked the way that he played the game. It was hard. So I think mentality-wise, Scott Rowland gave me a lot. I love Lance Berkman, how he had the ability to compete but also have fun in the game. There was some other guys too, those two conversations. And then, you know, the conversations with the pitchers are great because you're sitting there facing Madison Bumgarner, Zach Greinke. These are guys in the division all the time, right? So I have 60, 70 ABs. Matt Cain was someone who I had a great deal of success. So he's coming up to me on the bus just saying, dude, how good do you see the ball against me? And then you're honest with him and said, man, I could see every single pitch. But then they, you know, you have it on the opposite end where there's guys that you have no success against. And then all of a sudden you know, it kind of takes the, they become almost friends to where it takes off the edge a little bit, because now you've had conversations, you know what the guy's like. So I always felt like that was funny during an All-Star game, that after you face them after an All-Star game, it was completely different than before.
And what about some of your later All-Star weekends, like, you know, your fourth or fifth? Were there instances where, and I know you are somebody who tries to be good to younger players, did you see some of yourself in a younger player at some point where that maybe, you know, they came up to you at an All-Star game event trying to pick your brain?
Yeah, I saw that towards the end of my career with a couple of guys. But I really kept it close with my teammates, so I gave a lot of my information to Nolan Arenado, Trevor Story, DJ LeMahieu. But someone that constantly approached me, I would say, that I tried to just give them, hey, man, this is what I would have done differently if I could do it all over again, would be a guy like Carlos Correa, being a shortstop, being a big-body shortstop. He would always, you know, come up to me in BP and want to talk about the position and what he needed to do to get better. So he's someone that comes to mind, but there's a lot of guys over the years, but he's someone that always felt like he had interest in really being the best in the game and wanted to know, you know, what it took.
Well, let's talk about playing in Colorado. You were there a very long time. By this point, you are for sure a Rockies legend. Michael Kadire works with us at USA Baseball and has been on this podcast, and he talked about when he went from Minnesota to Colorado. I think he said it was Walt Weiss's first season as manager. And he raved about Weiss bringing in these guest motivators, saying that, you know, he was a little bit outside the box and he was trying to get you guys to think in similar terms. And there was one in particular. He was like a combat fighter, like a mixed martial artist.
GSP, George St. Pierre.
Yeah. So, and Kadire, when I asked him about that season in Colorado, where it was kind of like, well, man, everything clicked for him, he credited that talk as something that he used all season long, just about getting in the right mind space before games. Does anything else stick out when it comes to Weiss bringing these people in and anything that stuck with you and changed the way that you approached, even just in a minor way?
Yeah, well, I think that's why you do things like that, because, you know, you don't know what's going to click with what guy. So, you know, with Cuddy, that might have put him, you know, to the next level of hearing GSP talk. Something might have registered and something he really thought about maybe before and after a game that made the difference. You know, for me, I don't have one experience like that, but I think I tried to always be someone who, you know, was in books as far as reading about what makes greatness. Why are the great ones great? So I was on a constant search for that, whether I was studying Kobe Bryant, Tom Brady, guys like that always had interest in me. Novak Djokovic. Why is this guy the best at what he does? There's got to be something that drives that. There's got to be some type of preparation. I think that's what I found. I mean, they're always on. If they're not in a game, it's, you know, in the off season, they're still working on their craft. They really never get away from it. They understand that they have to. But man, it's difficult for them to get away because they love it that much. So I learned that over the years, really, is the best ones. And there's no secret. They put in the work. And it doesn't ever become a job to them. It's constant. There's no place they'd rather be than what they're doing.
What was your favorite thing about playing in Colorado?
In Colorado, I think it's really where kind of a boy became a man. I think I saw maybe my early years someone that was trying to prove, okay, I belong at this level. Can I do it? And then, you know, putting fast forward, like you said, making all-star games or being one of the better players in the game, whether it be gold gloves, silver sluggers, I just turned the corner mentally. And I stepped onto the field knowing that I was going to dominate instead of, okay, can I do this? And then, you know, off the field too, you know, you get a family, you turn into a man at some point. And, that happened with me in Colorado. So I'll always remember that. And, you know, I would say that's probably what sticks out to me about playing there.
You mentioned Todd Helton earlier, and I told you I'm based in the Triangle area of North Carolina. So Durham is not far off, and working in sports media, I've gotten to know David Cutcliffe a bit, who's the Duke football coach. And he was the offensive coordinator at Tennessee when Helton was Peyton Manning's backup. So he's provided some good context as far as, you know, Helton the person, Helton the player over the years. What made Todd Helton so great?
Well, first, you know, I would say I've met both Elliot Avent and Coach Cutcliffe, and you're surrounded by some pretty good people over there because those are two of the best guys I've met. You could just tell they have huge hearts and love what they do. So you're in great company.
Over yeah, there. Amen, man. They're both great.
They are. And, you know, with Helton, I think Helton's one of those guys that he's not going to give you much until he trusts you. But once you're in, it feels like a brother. And he watched me for, I would say, almost about a full year. He watched how I approached the day, made sure I was the right guy, that the work ethic was there. And you can learn a lot from him by just watching him each and every day. You talk about mentally tough. You talk about a grinder. You talk about work ethic. Never gave away an AB. Fouled off pitch after pitch and really played through pain really at the end of his career. I could tell that his back was bothering him. And he'd still be in that cage working and never complained one time. So I learned that from Todd of you just get after it. You don't complain. And he's someone that you want on your side because he shows up each and every day to really just beat his opponent, kind of old school baseball. And I'm glad I got to be his teammate and, you know, a good friend.
I think we all know him for his consistency on the field and the numbers that we see when we look him up on Baseball Reference or things like that. What's Todd Helton like off the field?
When you get to know him, he's going to be on whoever it is all the time, whether, you know, that's playing a joke on you or saying something really, really random just to get a reaction. He is always, always doing that. It could be a reporter coming in and he might get the most bizarre answer just to see, you know, the reaction. So he's on top of his game at all times in that aspect.
A couple things before I let you go, Troy, just because, I mean, you've experienced it all, so I think your perspective is really valuable on a couple of them. The existence and work life of a Major League Baseball player, I think we take it for granted how different it is. Just, you know, someone who's a fan, and you take for granted, oh, this guy could be traded from one city to another in the middle of his season, whereas no other job includes that possibility. So you were traded from the Rockies, where you grew up, essentially, as you put it earlier, to the Toronto Blue Jays, and it was in July. It was mid-season. What goes through your mind? What all goes into logistically getting there? I mean, that's something that, again, no other person, no other profession other than other professional sports really deals with that. And you know, 1 week you're a Colorado Rocky and have been your entire professional career, and then boom, just like that, okay, you gotta ship up to Toronto.
Yeah, that was the most probably toughest thing I had to face in my big league career, to be honest. You know, I signed up to be a Rocky for really my entire career. I took a lot of pride in that. You know, I think that's from kind of old school baseball, watching your favorite player play for the same team. That was always kind of my goal, as you can see, you know, my favorite players. Derek Jeter got to do that with the Yankees. Cal Ripken got to do that with the Orioles. So that was always my goal. So when I had that opportunity to sign up really for the rest of my career in Colorado, hey, you know, I took it. Well, things don't always work out, and you understand the game, you know, so much more when it's over. But I think we came to a point where they kind of wanted to go in a different direction. We got a new GM, and things kind of just, you know, unfolded behind the scenes. And there was a lot of pain. There was a lot of grief there because I was somewhat blindsided, by the trade. And I think that's, you know, it was talked about, but I kind of put it in the past, but things worked out for a reason. I went to Toronto. We had a great run there, but to move a family to a different country, it was difficult for me, especially when I felt like I put and gave everything I possibly had to that organization.
I was doing some research before this phone call, and look, I knew you were a really good defensive shortstop. We're about a handful of years apart from one another. I'm right at 30 years old. So I remember watching you at Long Beach State as a not so much younger guy who enjoyed baseball and ended up playing. I played at a Division III level and was an infielder. So again, it's something that it was obvious to me that you were a really good defensive shortstop. But I didn't quite realize, Troy, that you have the second best career fielding percentage in MLB history. And you're behind.
Yeah, that hurts.
You're behind only Omar Vizquel. Is that
something? Yeah, that hurts me when you say that. you know, to be honest with you, I didn't realize that until about halfway in my career, and someone was doing an interview and they brought that up to me. Well, at that point in time, I was number one. So after that conversation, I would always pay attention to that stat and say, all right, you know, my goal is to be the best fielding percentage shortstop in the history of the game. And it wasn't till sometime in Toronto that I made about two errors in 2 weeks, which, man, I don't know. And I moved to second place, and I didn't get in as many games under my belt after that because I ran into some injuries, unfortunately. So when you say that, I know how close I was to being, first, and me being how competitive I am. That hurts me to this day when I see that or people bring that up. So I appreciate you doing that.
It's funny, as this talk has gone on, I've got it in my notes here, and you keep talking about this chip on your shoulder, and I was like, man, I don't know how that's going to go. I don't know how that's going to go.
No, it's fine. I think Omar Vizquel.
Right.
That's not a bad guy to be behind, but I just took pride, man, in my job. I took pride in taking care of the baseball, and I think through fielding percentage, that kind of shows that. And that was, you know, you can ask my kids at the University of Texas. During practice, we strive for perfection. You better make every single throw right in the chest and every single ball we are trying to get. And if we make a mistake, we need to tell ourselves that is not okay, and that we're going to find a way to make that not happen again. And for anybody, you know, whether it be coaches or kids that end up listening to this, I just think if you can ever get to that point, that's what made me who I was, is that my practice was game-like, and I took a lot of pride in taking care of the baseball and playing the defense.
Well, I'm looking forward to, personally, and then the collective baseball world, figuring out what Troy Tulowitzki, the coach, is about. And with that being the case, you're obviously a process-driven guy. You don't like to look too far ahead, but you got to have goals. What's next for Tulo? I mean, obviously, you're, as it stands at Texas, do you want to turn that into a college coaching gig? Do you want to make your way back into affiliated ball? What's your mindset toward all that?
No, that's a great question. And I always try to go back to Ken Revisa, who was a huge part in my development. He's a mental skills coach that is not with us anymore. But I think anybody who's involved in college baseball or even in the pro ranks, I know he worked with Joe Maddon for a long time, but he always said, be where your feet are. So for me right now, I'm the volunteer assistant, at the University of Texas. I really try to be where my feet are and try to be the best I possibly can. I'm trying to be the best role model and mentor for my kids that I have. And that's honestly, I don't try to go any further than that. I try to be the best infield coach, the best hitting coach, and I try to find a way to make us win games when they're on our schedule. And I really try to keep it as simple as that.
I respect it, man. This has been a lot of fun. I mentioned growing up as a young shortstop, watching you on TV and stuff. So it's been kind of cool personally for me, because back when I was playing and a teenager and in my early 20s, much like Jeter was someone you emulated that's not far off your age, you were somebody I looked up to as a player. So it's been cool to catch up now that you're doing your thing coaching at Texas and be able to bring it all full circle. But as a representative of USA Baseball, we are incredibly proud that you're an alum with your collegiate national team experience. And again, thanks for the time. Best of luck at Texas. And hopefully we'll get to be playing some baseball here pretty soon.
Yeah, that sounds great to me. And I appreciate the kind words. Anything you ever need, let me know. And yeah, man, thank you.
Well, that does it for episode 25 of Covering the Bases. Thanks again, as always, for listening. And a reminder, rate and review the podcast, if you would, wherever you subscribe. It's available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and we also post every episode to the USA Baseball YouTube channel as well. So my thanks again to Troy Tulowitzki for joining us. That was a lot of fun. This was a big one. We hit a little bit of a milestone, number 25. There's plenty more good stuff to get to. Great USA Baseball alumni to talk to. So I look forward to having you with us for episode 26 and beyond. Stay safe, be well, and until next time, I'm Daron Vaught, and I'll catch you later.